Hello everyone, welcome to this next video. Last time we began discussing the interpretation to the Schrödinger equation, and in particular we talked about Born's statistical interpretation of this equation. Now what this said is basically that this wave function that you get from the Schrödinger equation will allow you to determine, among other things, the probability of finding this particle between some position x and some other position x plus dx. This is determined by the square of the absolute value of this wave function. How to do this, as I said, we will see in detail somewhat later. And we saw this example of some random wave function, and we saw that we can interpret this as seeing that this particle would have a high likelihood of being found in the vicinity of point A, while it would have a relatively low likelihood of being found around point B. Now, what if we made an experiment to see where exactly we can find this particle? And in that experiment, we determined that the particle was found here at position C. The question now is, what does this tell us, or what can we say about the position of the particle before we conducted our experiment? And that is one of the most important questions of quantum mechanics. And there are several possible answers to this. Now, the first one, and I think it's one of the most logical ones, especially when you just start getting into quantum mechanics, is what is called the orthodox position. That is the next one, the realist position. The orthodox will come later. So the realist position basically says that the particle was always located at point C. We just didn't know it. So what this says is that quantum mechanics is incomplete. It says that there is just something that we don't know, and if we did, we could always determine the result of an experiment. We could always predict it. It would also eliminate this thought that the universe is random, or there is some element of uncertainty that is just in the nature of our reality. That is what the realist position claims. Now, the second one, as I already spoiled, is the orthodox position, and it's also called the Copenhagen interpretation. This is by far the most accepted position, and what it claims is that the particle wasn't really anywhere before we conducted our experiment. This position defends this somewhat uncertain nature of our reality. You said that there's just some things that it's not that we don't know, because there is just nothing to know. The particle is not anywhere before we conduct the experiment. The particle is spread out in space, as we can see in this wave function, and that is just something that we have to deal with. Now, the question of how exactly does this particle decide if it's going to be measured at C or A or B or at some other point, that is something that, unfortunately, we still do not know. And it would obviously be very interesting to have an answer, but I'm afraid, at least to this day, there is just not really a satisfying answer to that question. Now, there are obviously some other possible answers or positions. For example, there's the many worlds interpretation. And this one claims that it's not that a particle just decides where it's going to be measured, it's that every single possible outcome of the experiment occurs, and we just happen to live in a world, or in a reality, in a universe, in which we detect this outcome. Now, obviously, this would have some tremendous consequences. It would really change the way we view not only the universe, but also ourselves, our place in the universe. So obviously it would be very interesting. There's many movies about this kind of topics, but unfortunately, or fortunately, I don't know, it's not really something that you can test. So as I said, the most acceptable or accepted position as of now is this Copenhagen interpretation. And just as a fun fact, Einstein was actually, at least at the beginning, a really big defender of the realist position. And Bohr was one of the main defendants of the Copenhagen interpretation. They had a lot of heated discussions, as far as I know. Well, there's just one last thing that we need to discuss about this, and it is, what if we conduct a second experiment, a second measurement of the same experiment right after we did the first one? So we measured that the particle was at point C, and immediately after we want to conduct another measurement. What should we get? What we get in experiments is that the particle is once again at point C, assuming of course we perform this measurement fast enough. Because once we measure, we collapse the wave function. We basically force this particle to take a stand, and after that it is at point C. It is slowly going to spread. Well, obviously it depends on your frame of reference what you call slowly, but it will once again spread out over time, which is something that we will see in the Schrödinger equation. But at least if you perform this measurement fast enough, you can see that the particle is still going to be centered around this point C. Okay, and this is obviously because we already measured it. If we had not measured it, we could just get some different result. Okay, so this is just one of the interpretations of this Schrödinger equation. Obviously, as we stated, quantum mechanics raises a lot of questions about physics and our reality and experiments and just how much we can actually know about the universe. We will talk more about this when we talk about the uncertainty principle. But for now, I will leave it at this. Let me know what you think of this. Which position do you think is the most adequate to represent our reality? And well, I'll be seeing what you write down in the comment section. So I'll see you next video.